कैन टेक ओवर एंड यू कैन प्रोसीड सर।
विद्या मैम प्लीज।
गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी, थैंक यू हेतल एंड अनिल फॉर अरेंजिंग दिस प्रोग्राम वेयर वी कैन ऑल शेयर एक्सपीरियंसेस विद दोज ऑफ आवर कलीग फेलो टासियंस हु हैव रिकवर्ड फ्रॉम कोविड। So the situation is obviously quite serious. We are having more than, as of today, we have more than 6 lakh. Somebody's audio, there is some background. Can you just
please,
mute?
Please stop the audio. Yeah. Everybody else.
So we have more than 63 lakh cases, which is not a joke, and we are close to 1 lakh deaths. But still, you know, we are returning back to normal and we are trying to get on with our lives as well as we can. And as far as India is concerned, official fatality rate is 1.6%, and they are counting the cases from day one and asymptomatic everybody, and they're showing a recovery rate of 83.5%. So and mortality rate is only less than 2%. So in that sense, we are doing better than many other countries. We are glad to have our fellow Tassians who have had the infection and recovered successfully. So I would like to start today's program with a small prayer, like to all the sort of gods of health and medicine. And the Dhanvantri is our Hindu god of medicine, and I have a special link because Jipmer actually, the postal address is Dhanvantri Nagar. So our Jipmer, where I studied my MBBS, that area is called Dhanvantri Nagar, and it actually started as Dhanvantri Medical College, and then it was subsequently renamed as Jawaharlal Institute of Medical Education and Research. So our fellow Tassian Meenal, who is our star singer, is unable to join us today, but she was kind enough to record this Dhanvantri Shloka and send it to us despite my very short notice. So I will just try to share that now, and if I cannot, Shishir will share it.
Can we hear this?
Madam, can't hear it.
Can't hear it.
Shishir, can you share this?
समुद्र मंथन के दौरान सभी रोगों
को ये धनवंतरी भगवान
ही लेकर प्रकट हुए थे। Now we can hear. धनवंतरी को विष्णु जी का अवतार बताया जाता है। धन्वंतरी मंत्र का जप करने से आरोग्य की प्राप्ति होती है। आइए हम भगवान धन्वंतरी से प्रार्थना करें कि हमें, हमारे प्रियजनों को तथा संपूर्ण विश्व को आज की इस विकट कोरोना परिस्थिति से लड़ने की रोग वर्धक क्षमता दें तथा दीर्घ आयु प्रदान करें। तो चलिए पूरी श्रद्धा और विश्वास के साथ तीन बार मिलकर इस मंत्र का जाप करते हैं। ओम नमो भगवते महासुदर्शनाय वासुदेवाय धन्वंतरये अमृत कलश हस्ताय सर्व भय विनाशाय सर्व रोग निवारणाय त्रैलोक्य पतये त्रैलोक्य निधये श्री महाविष्णु स्वरूप श्री धन्वंतरी स्वरूप श्री 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 औषध चक्र नारायणाय स्वाहा। ओम नमो भगवते महासुदर्शनाय वासुदेवाय धन्वंतरये अमृत कलश हस्ताय सर्व भय विनाशाय सर्व रोग निवारणाय त्रैलोक्य पतये त्रैलोक्य निधये श्री महाविष्णु स्वरूप श्री धनवंतरी स्वरूप श्री 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 औषध चक्र नारायणाय स्वाहा ओम ओम नमो भगवते महासुदर्शनाय वासुदेवाय धन्वंतरये अमृत कलश हस्ताय सर्व भय विनाशाय सर्व रोग निवारणाय त्रैलोक्य पतये त्रैलोक्य निधये श्री महाविष्णु स्वरूप श्री धन्वंतरी स्वरूप श्री 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 औषध चक्र नारायणाय स्वाहा धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू शिशिर फॉर बेलिंग मी आउट। So we know for a fact that you know we have lost about 1 lakh people in India, and out of which the statistics is probably completely inaccurate or incomplete. But definitely more than 400 of our doctor colleagues we have lost, other than so many other healthcare workers, including nurses and other allied specialties. So I would like all of you to join me in to observe 1 minute silence in honor of our departed colleagues. Thank you everybody for observing a moment silence, and welcome one and all, though all Thasians, including those who are watching us on Facebook Live. It was the idea of Hetal and Anil to have this meeting where we could talk to our own colleagues who have gone through the problem and come out successfully, and here is to hoping that all others who are at the moment not doing well will also recover successfully. Our special prayers to Nidhi. Hope you will be back soon, back to work soon. Nidhi, can you please unmute yourself? So Nidhi is just actually at the moment still in isolation, and she's tested positive, fortunately having only very mild symptoms, and probably the youngest of us who has faced this problem. Nidhi, what were your initial feelings when you realized that you are probably having the infection?
I'm actually first of all, I developed a fever while I was in COVID duty, so I was not sure because I had a heavy evening duty, and then the very next day I had a very heavy morning duty. So I felt like, okay, that's because of the workload that I was having. But that was a one day fever spike. So I was, of course, worried because of this COVID scenario, because the fever was 101 degree. So I informed my seniors, and the very first feeling was like, I should not get positive. Because I was in the middle of COVID duty, I want to get done with the duties. I was worried about who will do my duty. So I was a bit terrified.
So you were actually somewhere, you were swinging between denial and mortal fear. Like, it's not. And so eventually, what made you actually go and get tested?
Ma'am, actually, we had a protocol here. Because of fever, I had to get tested after 5 days isolation. So after 5 days isolation, I was having not a single symptom. But on the day of test, I got some nasal blockage. And in the evening, by the time I got result, I had loss of smell and taste. So I was quite sure that this is COVID only.
So I'm glad to know that you have had very mild symptoms, and that
I had very mild symptoms.
And have you crossed the 7 to 10 days from onset of symptom?
Yes, ma'am. And even I had some smell sensation also.
So, oh, great! So your smell is already recovering. So I hope that you're going to be fine. So among all of us, you know, one of the most fittest and very, athletic and very, very physically fit person is Dr. Deepti Mehta. She runs marathons, she does cyclethons, and, you know, name it, she has done it. And even the COVID did not stop her from participating in virtual marathons and all that. So, Dr. Deepti, yours would be a unique perspective. Did you think that, were you doing COVID duty as well? Like Nidhi was doing COVID duty, so it was kind of, you know, for want of a better word, inevitable. But did you think that it would, get to you as well? That
COVID, no, ma'am. No, for me also, it was very unexpected. Actually, listening to the stories of COVID since January and February in China, and then getting ready in March for the how to treat the patient. And when our city faced the peak in the August and September, when it knocked on our door, actually, mentally, I was totally unprepared, I must say. Listening to the stories and coming at your own house was very, very different. I never expected it to be there. So it was different.
So what?
Thanks, ma'am.
You were also a victim of what we call as optimism bias. Like, we think it won't happen to us. It happens to others, not to us.
So like, yes, yes. Something.
If it's happening in China, it's not going to come to India. Then we say, okay, yes, it's happening in Chennai, it's not going to come to,
yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So, same feelings, so, yeah, actually.
I'm glad to see that you have also fully recovered. But you did mention that there were some family members who got, infected as well.
Yeah.
So you got infected first, or others got infected first? I mean, others got infected first.
Ma'am, in my family, three of us got infected. But actually, I was not having any symptoms, not a single spike of fever. But I just tested positive, whereas my son was having a mild symptom with fever only. And my husband was having a moderate COVID. So I went through all the phases, like without symptoms to the moderate COVID, which was quite disheartening to see him suffer. I was there, but it was very disheartening. So,
what made you get yourself tested, ma'am? Since you didn't have any symptom,
He was tested positive. So then all of us family members, six of us are there. We all got tested. Amongst that, three of us were positive and three were negative. Amongst that, two are senior citizens, like above 80. So they, three of them were negative. And we three positive. So we got home quarantine only. But we stayed upstairs and they stayed downstairs. That's what we managed.
Yeah, true. Those of us who have elderly people at home, we have a special fear, right? Because my mom is 81 and she's with me. And my husband has a post-head injury, very severe sequelae, and he's got very poor respiratory function and all. So for us, the worry is more about others than us. We feel that, okay, if we may get away with it, but, you know, if our parent or elderly relative gets, means we are in, that guilt feeling is there. So Kamala mentioned that she had very mild symptoms, but her dad had severe and landed up in hospital. Kamala, can you unmute yourself and tell us what happened in your case? unmute yourself, Kamala. We can't hear you.
I was in my ICU posting when I got infected, ma'am. It was only 7 days since my ICU posting has started. And just then I got oriented to the ICU posting. Then I developed symptoms. I had a mild fever. And so immediately I isolated myself. And 2 days later I tested and I became positive. So my first worry was about two people, ma'am. One was my father. He's diabetic, hypertensive and around 60 years old. And then one of my colleagues, ma'am, she was around 28 weeks pregnant. So these two people, I was very much worried about them. But luckily, my friend did not get the infection from me, but she was a very close contact. But my father, he was infected. Both my parents, we tested them since I became positive. Both of them were positive. My mother, she also had only mild symptoms like me. And my father, initially, he did not have much symptoms, but we started the treatment for him. Around the 10th day, he developed symptoms. Breathlessness was there and his saturation was dropping. So immediately, we admitted him in the hospital. He was there for 1 week and slowly he recovered after that, ma'am. So this was the thing. And
so both Nidhi and you mentioned that you were on ICU duty when you kind of got infected. So do you think that the adequate safety precautions were being followed at your workplace?
Yes, ma'am. We followed adequate safety precautions.
So but you had adequate supply of proper personal protective equipment? That there was no problem regarding that?
No, there was no problem regarding that, ma'am.
Okay. So what you both, the experience of you two, what it shows is that it is not the lack of personal protective equipment or a lack of proper safety measures in the hospital is may not always be the reason. Because in the beginning, when the pandemic started and people started getting infected, the common reason cited was, oh, there's no N95 mask, there is no PPE, there's no proper SOPs in the hospital and things like that. But in one way, what you both have said is a little scary to me because most of us thought that if we follow adequate precautions and we have proper personal protective equipment, we will probably escape. So the other thing that comes to my mind is maybe in the COVID ICU, that is where maximum precautions are taken and all the protocols are followed. Do you think the weakest link is, say the outpatient or somewhere else, Shishir, would you like to say something about that? I mean, it doesn't have to be that you get infected in the COVID ICU, right? That is probably one of the safest places. We can't hear you. Yeah.
Actually, I was working in my OT and basically the source of infection was my colleagues and the technicians. Actually, we cannot work alone in our OT. Basically, we have to work with our colleagues or technicians. And basically, we are on much safer distance from our patients. We are taking more precautions with our patients. And especially with the known corona patients. Risk is much more with unknown corona patients and or with the staff. So I must mention here, you should take always proper precautions with your colleagues. Because you are, most of the time, you are taking tea or you are eating with them. That may be a cause of infection.
So actually, that is something actually what happened in our hospital because in May and all, we were not admitting any COVID patients at all. Okay. And anybody who was symptomatic or tested positive was not even being admitted in our hospital. Still, we had a cluster of staff. A huge number of staff nurses and people became infected when there was no positive case actually admitted in the hospital. And then when we did a root cause analysis, this is what we found that, in the negative areas, people tend to be more casual. They are not even wearing their mask properly. They're all huddling together, sharing tea, coffee, gossip and all that. So then after that, we had to put, systems in place to make people realize that community spread means the risk is more in, outside the COVID area, because in COVID area, everybody's careful. It's only outside the COVID area that we have more chance of getting infected. So that is the reason why I was surprised that we had two people who kind of temporarily, if you analyze, it seems that both of them got infected while working in the COVID ICU. So that is why I wanted that perspective. most of us are doing primarily anesthetists, and we are doing part-time intensive care as and required. I'd like to hear from Dr. Suresh Bhatto, who's actually an intensivist and has probably been leading the battle from the front right from the beginning of this pandemic. Dr. Suresh, can you please unmute yourself?
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening, sir.
I am at present practicing critical care, and we are not admitting the COVID patients in our ICU. But we have got one separate isolation area where we are admitting suspected cases. And after the COVID result, either we are transferring them to other hospitals, which are COVID dedicated hospital, or we are shifting in our ICU. Actually, I'm 60 plus with a diabetes. So I was taking the proactive measures that I can come across any COVID patients. So I was taking this SCQ right from March, April. And I was controlling my diabetes, and diabetes was well controlled because these were the comorbid conditions are there. And along with this, I was reducing my BMI also. I lost nearly 6-7 kg weight, and BMI is a very important factor for the doctors as a you know, risk factor. And along with this, many people are advising us for the kada and all this thing, but I was not taking any kada, but I was taking this black seeds.
Sorry?
Black seeds. That is the, you know, black seeds which we use in the making pickles. That is, in Hindi, it is known as kalonji.
Kalonji, yeah.
Kalonji. Somebody advised me to take kalonji in the April or May. Then since then, I was taking the kalonji, and I lost weight 6-7 kg during 3 or 4 months. Then I studied kalonji. After I thought that this weight may be intentional or unintentional, then I went through all the investigations. They were all right. But surprisingly, my cholesterol and triglycerides was very low. Then I read this kalonji, because it has got the anti-inflammatory action, as well as it reduces the cholesterol. On 2nd of September, one post-operative patient admitted in our ICU after the TKR, bilateral TKR. And he was having hypotension, saturation was normal with the oxygen, nasal prong. And he was having the GI symptom one day before, post-operatively. Normally, I do not put the rice tube, and that patient was also not requiring urgent rice tube insertion. But anyway, I don't know what happened, and I decided to put the rice tube in that patient. And that patient was COVID negative. After putting the rice tube, during rice tube insertion, I took measure. I used the goggles as well as respirator, 3M respirator. But I was wearing the scrub, surgical scrub. I didn't wear the gown. Normally, I am wearing the impermeable gown in an ICU, but on that particular moment, I didn't wear the gown. And after the insertion of the rice tube, my colleague radiologist told me that this patient has got CT chest suggestive of COVID. I had exposure of 6 to 8 minutes during manipulation with the magus, with the laryngoscope and magus. So I got the high exposure with this, but I was following it. Because I was during doffing also, I took all the precaution that how I can reduce the viral load. And because I was monitoring myself, fortunately, I didn't have any symptoms. But my saturation was all right. And but I had fever. That fever also I was monitoring, because I was following that case. On the fifth day, I got the fever. And this was 101. Then I got tested myself. It was, RT-PCR positive. And because I am doctor, and doctor's mortality is more than 10%, and I'm 60 plus, so I decided with the guidance of my cousin, she's in USA, and she's dealing with a COVID patient. She advised to early admission and early remdesivir. So I got admitted next day and started remdesivir, and I didn't took steroids because my saturation was all right. So within 3 days, I was temperature free. I never had myalgia. I never had body ache and no other symptoms. So lungs score was, 1/25. So CT scan also lung was not involved. So I was fortunate enough. Maybe this may be hydroxychloroquine, or I was taking at least some PPE measures which reduced the viral load. So this was the, but the message which I want to give to doctors, that they should get, they should be proactive in diagnosis also, and they should get as early as possible in the hospital and should start the remdesivir, especially the doctors which has got the some, high risk risk factor is there.
Thank you Dr. Bhargav, for sharing your experience. Dr. Deepthi passingly mentioned that when she got infected and her son had mild symptom and her husband had moderate, it was much more disheartening for her to see her husband suffer more than her. So my colleague Chinu had a similar experience. So Chinu, would you like to say something about
yes,
how the entire family had to go through this, and what were your feelings when others in the family also got infected, right?
Yeah, from April and May, I was actually getting tensed about the COVID situation. I contracted it in June 20th, and I had some myalgia, sore throat, headache, and I was feeling very tired. And from the next day, my husband and my two kids, both of them, three of them got fever. My children had low-grade fever, while my husband had fever and cough. And by that time, we had to isolate ourselves as a family. And I also had a loss of taste and smell, but the other three didn't have those symptoms. The children, surprisingly, they recovered in that day itself. Like, the fever gone, just one small spike of fever, very less tiredness for them. But my husband had a fever and cough for another three more days. I didn't have fever. I was tired all the time. The myalgia was present for almost 2 weeks. And we slept a lot. But around day seven, I got a kind of inspiratory pleuritic pain. So that was one difference was there. And took a CT and it showed a mild GGOs, ground glass opacities. So me and my husband also had mild changes, and we both had to be put on oral steroids. With that, we improved immediately. It was a very drastic change. And within 14 days, day 14, all the tiredness had been gone. We were home isolated throughout. That is my experience. The thing is, there is an anxiety element that is also there. Around day 10, we get kind of anxious, and that maybe it has to do something with the cytokine release or something, and an indescribable feeling of that anxiousness, anxiety and helplessness.
A sense of impending doom, sense of impending doom.
Actually,
in June, the incident numbers in the country as well as Chennai, everything was very low. So those days, if we got it, we felt that it was something. Right now, today, we are thankful every day we don't get, because, it's, community spread is established and everybody. So if you don't get, you are the lucky one. But those days, we used to, anybody who gets will feel guilty. Oh, what did I do wrong? Should I have done this? And, especially when a family member gets infected, there are all kinds of doubts come. Because of me, my family is affected. And, Chinu actually lives in a non-medical environment, but one of the good things is that in Chennai, Nidhi and Kamala can also add in, I don't know, but we have actually not faced any discrimination. I mean, we have not had any social stigma. In fact, non-medical people have stepped up and helped, and for Chinu, her neighbors are all non-medical. But they all stepped up and helped. That is a very heartwarming sign. And actually, recently, one of our colleagues' birthday. So because now we all celebrations, everything stopped. We don't do anything. But we thought, okay, at least in an open place, we will go and just three, four of us will go and just sit for a while with masks and all. So actually, the birthday girl landed up in her scrub suits. and she walked, you know, in one place just outside our hospital. But it was, I was really amazed that, you know, from the public, we did not feel any, nobody looked at her funnily or nobody tried to move away from us or anything. So that is a good sign in the middle of all this violence and so many places where people have been stigmatized. We have to be thankful that still there are some people who are, you know, very helpful and kind. So we are glad to have Dr. Raghavendran join us. Good evening, sir. Sir, everybody was just telling us about, like, you know, how they landed up testing and what happened and all. So we'd like to hear from you also, sir. If anybody has two devices on, please switch one off because there's an echo.
Hello. Am I audible, Dr. Pia?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good evening. Actually, good evening to all the viewers, you know, who are seeing this program. And I think it's some sort of, you know, relief only we are, I'm just in front of you. It was last month, you know, around, say, 20th or so, when I thought just because of, you know, we are working hard, you know, and then Sundays also, I was doing some work cleaning up. You know, so Monday, got a little bit, you know, tired feeling was there. Body aches and all. Didn't take it very seriously. Just took Crocin and went to the hospital. And then past 4 months, somehow, no, we never caught on this corona. We're doing all cases, limited ones, of course, but with full PPE. I don't know where it came from, which source, really mystery, actually, you know. And evening, when I came back, I was having some sort of a feverish feeling was there. They tested, it was about 100. Wife had the same. In fact, before I complained, my wife was saying, I'm having fever. Okay, so we both developed simultaneously, you know, the same time, I would say. Then next day, I thought, I contacted our ID specialist, our Vijayalakshmi. She said, just wait one more day because only after 48 hours, it may show something. Then after 48 hours, when we tested, it was positive, you know. So it was something like, you know, when you open the result, I mean, when you see the email, you know, the thing it came, it was like, you know, you are looking at the result and the result pass or fail. It was something like, you know, when you see a fail feel, you know, you feel that sort of the tension which goes through your, you know, body and mind, that's what, you know. So, and I belong to that category, you know, where I think we're not supposed to be getting corona at this age, you know. And I got a knack of getting into a health problem year after year. Last year, it was a major problem. This year again, I don't know which was more, probably this time, but somehow, no, then see, I am past 60, wife is also past, she turned 60 maybe a few months ago, and then I got a mother-in-law who is 85. Okay, so, and I got two sons, so doctors. So thing is, no, when then all things come into your mind, run into your mind. So what we're going to do, when break away from the work is something. But you really worry about many things, and that is a time, you know, when our beloved singer, you know, was also admitted in SPB, and then he was going through a very torrid time, and then he had a ventilator, and then and he was going on ECMO and all these things. So it's more of a real mental agony, mental tension, anxiety. And then the whole family, three of us, myself, wife, and next day when they tested my mother-in-law, she was having a fever, she was positive. Okay, so 85 years old, so high risk category. In all houses, all know, they isolate the corona patients into separate rooms. In our house, we were a majority. See, three of us in a house, and then we had to isolate my boys, okay, because see, they are young and all. We don't want them to catch this also. No? So, and then promptly the results are announced. The next day, the corporation people came and closed the door and then sprayed all over that door, whatever that disinfectant and bleaching powder, and how that helps really. Corona spread now. So they put a bold sticker and everyone who was scared to come anywhere near house. No? We wanted to order for some food and all, no? Because wife wanted to take some rest now. And the person usually supports us with, you know, the food items. So, no, he refused to come. No, I won't come. But the common people, you know, the people who are coming and asking every day, oh, they've got fever. You know, I think probably they must have got bored about asking us every day. And then finally, they must have got thrilled because we have become positive, probably. You know, so. Okay, That's how it went. No, so I think that first week of the corona, I think we didn't have much of symptoms as such, about maybe 3 days. And we just thought we just isolate ourselves at home quarantine. And as per, you know, Dr. Jirikshmi also said, okay, fine, you be at home. But anytime if anything happens, you just come away to hospital. You know? But as far as my mother-in-law is concerned, she said, I think better get admitted. But she wouldn't just let it go. And then somehow she was actually, you know, steady. And then she never had any serious symptoms. Probably, you know, people of those days, you know, they are all of stronger stuff. You know? That's what I feel. Hmm? And we didn't have any antivirals, no dexamethasone, nothing of that sort. Only crocin, SOA, that only for 3 days, after nothing. Only all the zinc and vitamin, those things only. And the Ayurvedic thing, no, the Gabbasura, that one I'm taking. For what it's worth, no, but probably that really helped actually. And I wrote in one of the, I told Dr. Hital also, no, he and one of the posts, no, he mentioned about the experience. No, so just told that really helped. Don't have any scientific proof for that, but for something better than nothing. No? I thought that's better than weighing all these antivirals and this and that. No? So
Dr. Raghavendran, one of the important points that you have brought out, which also actually the last grand rounds, 10th grand round on COVID from AIIMS just came out a couple of days ago. There they presented a case of a 92-year-old lady who had COVID, became serious, went on ventilator, and successfully weaned and extubated with multiple comorbids, including previous stroke. So I think we should not just assume that just because somebody is old, if they get COVID, they're going to die. Like, you know, that means, of course, we have to tell high risk so that they don't indulge in any risky behavior. But it's not like just because you're old and you get COVID, you're going to die. That I think we should give some positive feedback to the elderly also, that, you know, it doesn't mean that because you're above 80, if you get COVID, you're going to die. Like, you know? So,
I would say ignorance is bliss. I think she was not really aware about the serious situation. So that really sailed her through. So I think she came out without any problem as such, you know, and that probably must have thought some flu, why people are making so much of fuss. You know? And she used to come out and try to mingle with my sons also. I said, no, please don't infect them. It becomes a problem. Then I think she was convinced enough to go and isolate herself in a room. No? But actually, no, it was not we who isolated ourselves. It was the children, no, the sons who got isolated actually. Because they are majority, the affected ones. But somehow it
so I have a question for both you and Dr. Suresh. What was the response to your family? Because the general talk was, you know, above 60 minutes, don't go out, don't work and all. So were your wives and family members were upset with you that you were continuing to work when you should have, did they feel that you should not have gone to work, you should have stayed at home? Or what was the reaction from your family? No. Because in my hospital, we have had young doctors, DMOs and all, resigning or refusing to work in COVID ward or COVID ICU and all that, claiming that their parents told them, don't work. If you don't have to work, you come and sit at home, but don't do COVID duty. So apparently, there are parents like that. So I'm just curious whether your wives and all were happy that you were going to work when you are 60 plus, like, or did your son say, no, you should not go to work or whatever.
No,
like,
no.
Just curious.
No, I don't think that really matters. I think the age as such, provided you got a good, solid, something like a physique, and then I believe that we are all exposed to a lot of this infection as such. We develop some sort of immunity, and probably being in the medical profession, exposure to all these viruses, this and that, and then we become a bit strong anyway, I think over a period of time. I don't think, probably non-medical, I think probably the reaction which the people develop as after an exposure to COVID varies different people, okay? So we have seen even young people, 32 years also, someone was working in SRMC and then he was like in the obese side. He landed up ventilated very soon and then he didn't survive actually. Even some children have gone also. And many old people have survived. I think it's a constitutional makeup which I think that's what I feel. So all that they say, diabetics and ischemic heart, all problems are there, but then we never had that thing. I think the reaction to the virus, that very, I don't know whether there are any different strains are there, because what we had is very quite a mild ones, like any other younger people who have gone through this problem and all. No major problem assets. No. It's just like any other upper respiratory infection. That's all I would say. Maybe a little. But the mild thing was that you get really tense because I think the media is so much of, you know, at it, this hype going on now. So then suddenly you start thinking all kinds of things. Imagine things and then what's going to happen to children, this and that. That's what is really, you know, troubles you. But otherwise,
So what I wanted to ask next was, how did you, Dr. Deepthi, maybe you can start. How did you get over this negative feeling? That is, first is this, impending sense of doom, especially when your loved ones are not there. And like sir was telling, your mind plays tricks on you. So how did you manage yourself? I know you are a very strong lady, but so I am asking you the question. Please unmute yourself and tell us, how did you mentally kind of strengthen yourself to face this problem which had come to your family?
Ma'am, thanks, madam. Mentally to stay strong in this condition was actually very difficult. As I said, the first week was quite okay without having much of the problems, and we were just taking antivirals and the antipyretics. But second week, when it took us to a roller coaster ride for my husband, it was very difficult to keep insane because he was going through so much. Like he was having real bad cough, which was not getting treated with any of the drugs like nebulizers, steams, and antihistaminics. Nothing was, and I was really just seeing him like tossing and turning. It was difficult, ma'am. It was very depressing being an anesthetist that you are not able to help him a lot. So that was not really helping me at that time. You turn to other ways of like Ayurvedic or other allopathic, other alternative medicine, but still nothing helped. So that was not good. Plus he was going through a lot of complications also. So at that time, I don't think you were thinking of anything other than treating the complications. Like as the steroids were started, he had one episode of a hypertensive crisis where the BP shot up to 220 by 120. And like we had to treat it with oral diuretics and antihypertensive drugs. But that time you are already on LMWH and you are scared of stroke and ICH and all sort of complication goes in your mind. And I think some of these complications don't let you think about anything than to just treat it. You are treating the symptoms and hyperglycemia. He required insulin also for that. Only positive thing I was seeing was like I was positive. So I could monitor him very well. And I was there throughout this ordeal. That was one thing. And another thing, like he used to have a laryngeal stridor also. When SpO2 used to drop to 90 and I would get a cylinder from the hospital, it was very difficult, ma'am. But thing is, once the laryngeal stridor episode was over, he was maintaining his saturation between 92 to 96. So that was positive sign. So actually, when you are going through, I don't think anything else than to just treat it. And then you think you become little spiritual, then you become little believer in God and all that. And I would socially,
so
I would
what
say.
What made you not hospitalize him, madam, when the saturation was as low as 90? What made you continue with home care?
Actually, he immediately came to 94. So I was, okay, I'll wait till if he again develops, I'll admit him. That was the thing. And till that, and another thing, I was thinking that I would be monitoring him much better than if he's getting admitted. That was, being an anesthetist, I think it was my idea. I got a monitor, I got cylinder, I got all the resuscitative equipments at home. So that was main idea. So if he would have required oxygen, I would have definitely shifted him. And socially, I think a lot of friends also helps in this. If you have a lot of positive people around you, and who really support you in this ordeal, I think they too help. So I would be positive about that. Let at least keep positive people around you, I would say that way. And that's it.
Dr. Bhargav sir, would you like to add something? Suresh Bhargav sir?
My personal opinion for the people who are doctors, and the, for the people who are having any comorbid condition, they should be admitted in the hospital and they should get remdesivir as early as possible. Otherwise, in the first week of illness, it is very necessary to decrease the viral load. That is a scientific thing. But
yeah,
we should be, you know, away from the steroid in the first week unless your saturation is not dropping. These are the basic principle of these COVID treatment. And when remdesivir is available now, you might have seen the decrease in the mortality also. And I have seen the people who are initially treated at home with the, you know, Favi flu along with this Depo-Medro. Depo-Medro is not indicated when there is a no saturation drop. Later on, after 5 to 7 days, they are getting admitted in the hospital, and at that time they are starting remdesivir along with the steroid. So their condition is deteriorating. And I have seen this thing in many doctors personally. With they and me both started COVID at the same time. See, my friend took this Depo-Medro at home along with the Favi flu. But he landed in the ICU and he discharged 10 days or 15 days after I discharged. So my recommendation, especially for the doctor groups, because mortality in the doctors is 10%. It is not very 2% or 0.3%. In the general population is a 2% maximum. But for doctors, it is 10%. So to reduce the mortality among doctors, it is very necessary that it should be included, being a doctor should be included in the risk factors. And yes, because
I was looking to to hear from you about the emotional and you know, family aspect, that
yes, because, madam,
we can
madam.
Do a whole session on actual COVID management, but I was looking for
okay,
how
madam.
Did you
okay.
mentally cope with it. And how did your family respond? That would
madam,
be
my I was very stable because I was knowing that I took the proper precautions. So and my this comorbid condition was not such that I will be having the severe or moderate COVID. So I kept myself very balanced. And right from beginning of when I exposed, I was isolated in my other room. So fortunately, my wife and my son who was living with us. And they didn't get the COVID. So, and after I got the report, I immediately got admitted in the hospital. And fortunately, I didn't develop the much moderate symptoms. So by second or third day, I was very stable. So my family, initially they were upset, whole family was upset because by COVID, in the doctors, so many deaths are there. And everybody is seeing the media and watching in the media. So definitely my whole family was upset. But by third day, when I was okay, then everything was normal.
So Shishir, you are one of the probably exceptions where despite not having serious disease, you needed to be, because of protocol of your area or state, you were actually hospitalized and then again shifted and all that. So that must have been very, very, very difficult, right? It's so much nicer to be at home and, you have your pulse oximeter and you have your thermometer and you're just watching yourself and getting nice homemade food. Your family is just outside the door. That is so much nicer, isn't it? So how hard was it to be institutionalized?
But ma'am, the whole idea was to isolate my family from me. That was the most important part of this. Actually, I was very much worried about my old parents and my kids. So idea to get isolated in a hospital was a better compared to in home.
So it was by choice. It wasn't
isolation policy was not there. So I was admitted in the hospital. And after later on, I shifted to another hospital because of I was having fever, not reducing. It was increasing day by day and feeling more fatigue day by day. So I was shifted due to my pressure from my family, my wife and my friends. I was shifted to another specialty, which is SGPJ. It was just like my home because I worked there for so many years. So it was just like my home. And actually, in my opinion, the positive mind and faith in the God is the key for treatment. actually you should believe in yourself, otherwise it will be very difficult for to manage this.
Thank you, Shishir. Kamala, you mentioned about your dad getting sick, so that must have been very difficult time for you, because once he's not at home, you can't really look after him also, and you were both sick at the same time, is it?
Yes, ma'am.
So how did you cope with that, and especially with mom also not well? Must have been very difficult for you. So did you have anyone else to help, or how did it work for you?
We had a housemaid at home, ma'am, but she unfortunately she was also positive but asymptomatic. The thing is, we ordered food outside, and we managed with like that only. And our apartments people, I should tell, they were really, really supportive for us. So whatever we tell, they were buying for us, and they will keep it outside the house. So that was how we managed. And my father, when my father was admitted, my quarantine period was almost over. We admitted my father in my own hospital. Here only we admitted, where I'm doing DNB. So it was easy to communicate with the doctors. So about my father's condition, and I was allowed to visit him once a day like that, with all the PP kits and everything, ma'am. So, but mentally, initially I was very upset when my father became sick, but the only thing was my parents will become even more scared if they see me upset. So in front of them, I had to be like, I was very strong and I was very positive. And all my consultants and people here, they were also very supportive, ma'am. So with that, with everyone's support, we were able to sail through this crisis.
So that was the other question I wanted to ask. How did your colleagues react when you turned positive? Like, you know, work colleagues, what was the reaction, you know? And do people start asking you, oh, where do you think you got, or was there this a problem like that, or anything, or you know, everybody was just supportive and positive?
Everyone was very supportive, ma'am, and we just traced the contact, and we found that one of the ICU consultant was positive, and after that we were also following all my contacts, my co-PGs. The next day after I got symptoms, we also got symptoms, and three of the PGs, we were in the quarantine almost in the same period.
So you actually had a cluster.
Yes,
and again, like Shishir and Dr. Bhargav also said, probably most of us got infected from colleagues rather than directly from patients, right? Because we are much more careful with patients than we are with colleagues. So Poonam has just joined us. Poonam, can you unmute yourself? Yeah.
Yes. Hi. Good evening.
Good to know that you are getting almost tumhare chehre ki chamak wapas aa rahi hai. So
I don't think so. Maybe it is it.
Because compared to a few weeks ago, you're looking much better. So
yeah, that is nice.
God willing, by Diwali, you'll be totally as good as new. Navratri, Diwali will be as good as new.
Hope so.
I
joined back work right from the 14th day of infection.
Oh my God.
I mean, recovery or whatever you want to call it.
What made you not take some more rest? Because you had a fairly, you weren't like asymptomatic or mild, right? You had a little more.
Mildly symptomatic, but I had homophobia, you know, staying at home for such a long time. And so the OT was the only way I thought that, you know, I can distract myself and try to feel normal and come back to normal. So that was the only indication for joining back. But I think I should have taken rest. But then till how long? The duration, you never know. Like now also I feel that I should be taking rest. And then finally it should not happen that I rest in peace. So I just want to join back.
Don't even say that. So Poonam, we were just discussing about like Deepthi ma'am's husband got a little severe problem. And even Chinnu's husband had more symptoms than her. So yeah. I heard that for you also, entire family. So that, how did you handle, for want of a better word, that guilt and that anxiety and all, which when you feel that you are the cause of problem, you know, like that. So how do you
I generally prefer not to talk about it, because then the guilt is again, you know, you scribble the guilt, and then I really don't know whether I really was the source. Definitely I would have been. But
but there's no way of knowing. It's not like we are going to just train and prove.
There is no way of knowing. And secondly, what I have realized that it is not important to know what the real source is.
Exactly,
it may be community related. It may be me, or it may be anyone else. Basically, it was the virus.
So that is one of the things I wanted to bring up. So I don't think we should take too much guilt on us, because a lot of people who are supposedly sitting at home doing nothing are also getting infected.
They are also getting
people
infected.
People who are just, you know, going just for groceries and coming are also getting infected. Yeah. After all, we are not going deliberately and trying to get infection. It is our job. And in the middle of a pandemic, if we don't do our work, then what is our degree and what is our career? Nothing.
Yes,
so,
madam. And
as long
and
as
the
we
thing
take
is,
precautions, we have to understand that the possibility exists that we may get infected.
The thing is, none of my family members ever asked me that, do you think that the virus could have come from you? None of them ever asked me. It was always the others who asked me, what do you think, how did the virus enter? So we should stop asking such questions, that do you think that you are guilty? Do you think that you were the cause of infection? Do you think that you have brought the virus inside your home? That is really disheartening to answer, and that is, I don't know,
complete
it demotivates waste, the person.
Complete waste of this thing. But actually, in our apartment complex, we have quite a few doctors. But because of all this negative publicity, when COVID first started, we heard about people being evicted and doctors being beaten up and, you know, all kinds of things. So though I have lived in this complex for 20 years, everybody, you know, known to a lot of people, you know, so-called well-respected person and all that. But still in my mind, I had this fear. Yeah, I should not be the index case, you know.
Yes. You know what, madam?
Well,
I was the index case in my entire residential society. I was not the index case. I was the first faculty in my department to be positive. But in my residential society, yes, I was the first case. And because of so many rumors and news that used to come regarding the residential members, you know, disowning you from the society, nothing of that can happen to me. And that was a very good point. And I shared that already on the Facebook also, that they helped me a lot in overcoming the situation, because it is not only the COVID and the disease that is, you know, taking a toll on you. You have to think, as a female, you have to think about so many things. Who is going to cook? Who is going to throw the, you know, dustbin outside the house? Who is going to bring the food in? There's any number of things as a female, if you really get the virus, that you have to think. How you're going. I was so paranoid that I used to clean the house daily with hypochlorite and so on. But what I don't think I would be able to contribute much. But just one thing that I want to tell here now is that even if somebody who has recovered and has joined back, it is not, I had written this on the post also, that you always feel maybe you are recovered, but you have not cured of COVID. I still have certain repercussions of the disease yet. And recently I discussed with Deepti madam also, she gave me a very good post on long haulers. I used to believe that whatever is happening to me, I used to get tachy, brady. I did my 2D echo also. I was fearing viral myocarditis. See, I am not that kind of person who is, who gets anxious or apprehensive or scared of impending death. I have had a near-death experience in my past also. But this was something different. So I got my 2D echo done, which was good. But it was like ambiguous. You cannot really rule out whether I had a viral myocarditis. But there was tachy brady. So madam shared a very good article with me regarding long haulers. In that it is mentioned that there is dysautonomia, which is also common post-COVID. And the one thing that I liked in that article was, do not say that this particular symptoms is all the mind games. It may be something that is really happening in the mind. See, anosmia, for example, it could be a sign of demyelination of the olfactory nerve. So it is all pathological that is happening. So tachy brady. I used to believe that, is it anxiety? I used to never feel anxious, but it is anxiety or what? I don't know. After reading that article, I felt, okay, something is really happening inside and it is not mental. See, because people start believing something has happened to you at the mental level. So I think that whenever somebody has recovered and joined back, we should encourage that person to join and, you know, that everything is normal. That is what I want to say.
Yeah, thanks, Poonam. So this, I think, Shino, you also experienced this heart rate business, right? just unmute yourself. Unmute yourself. Unmute yourself. Chinu, unmute yourself.
Yeah. Around the 8th or 9th day, I had this feeling of sudden tachycardia and sudden tiredness. By that time, the cytokine storm, maybe I was also thinking, okay, 8th to 10th day, I should be careful. So, yeah, and around that time, I developed that pleuritic pain also. Yeah, it is kind of, and it is connected to some kind of anxiety. Also, and we a lot of contact with friends, video calls, all that helped, along with the treatment, of course, and food also. The, like you said earlier, the neighbors were giving outside the house, and
you've accidentally muted yourself. Yeah. So, Hetal, are you there? Hetal, are you there? Okay. No worries. So if somebody is following, the reason I asked for Hetal is if he's following in the Facebook Live, if there are any questions or anyone wants to say anything, then we can take up those questions also. But moving forward, what is the what should I say? What is the take-home message that you would like to tell those who are either undergoing the problem right now, or we are just trying. Like I always, whenever anyone sends me a message, how are you? Hope you are staying safe. Then I say, oh, I have successfully dodged COVID till now. So it's literally, I think we are just dodging, because it is probably inevitable that sooner or later most of us would get the infection unless there is a vaccine available or anything. So Dr. Raghavendran, what would you like to tell people who are bordering on paranoia? There are three types of population in the general population also, as well as in the hospital staff also. I see there is a bunch of people who are taking it easy, who whenever nobody is watching, the mask is down. There are one set of people who are paranoid, who are not coming to work even now, thinking of fomites and this and that and everything. And there are, I like to think that at least the majority of us, or above 50% of us, are the ones who are careful. Like, we try to keep things, we are neither taking it easy nor getting paranoid, trying to be somewhere in the middle. So what would be your, advice to colleagues and youngsters or anybody for that matter who's in the...
Yeah, I think, hello?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you hear now?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir, you're audible, sir.
Okay. We can't afford to drop our guard now. I think it is going to continue for some more time. And I think definitely there's going to be some complacency from the people who had a mild symptoms and recovered well. They probably think they are immune. We are not so. I think there are instances when people have got it also. So I think continue to cover yourself and with the full protection. And then I think some discipline has maintained also. I think what we used to observe, I feel that is not there now. I think probably people think that it's all dying out. No, it's not so. I think the incidence is still there, and then people are still getting infected, and some really seriously so. So I think until such time that it really flattened out, we have to observe all the precautions and then take full care and caution. That's it. That's what I think we should do. But I don't know about these prophylactic medicines. I don't know about that. But I think protection, yes, we can. Already I can sense that many people know who are doing a lot of, taking a lot of precautions like head box and then full PPE and so different. They're not doing it that much now. No? So some complacency is crept in already. And I think they have to maintain it for some more time. That's what I feel.
So, Shishir, if I had to ask you, what is the lesson that COVID-19 in general and you're getting infected in particular, if you like to say that some lesson that you learned out of this COVID pandemic as well as personally getting infected, what would it be, Shishir?
Ma'am, I started meditation after this COVID. This is the good thing, which really helped me a lot. And especially prayer and deep breathing exercise, it helped me a lot. So my message to my colleagues and my juniors is regular meditation and deep breathing exercise is required to cope up with this COVID. And always there is chances of reinfection. So this one infection is not the that you will not get another infection. So always take precautions. Always be cautious during your work, during your regular work. That is my idea. Because one of my colleagues, Dr. Viren Sharma, you must be knowing Dr. Viren Sharma, he's the treasurer of ISA. He got reinfected after 3 months and it was a relatively severe infection. He was febrile for so many days and was admitted in SGPGI. So always there is a risk of reinfection. So infection is not vaccination.
So if infection itself is not vaccination, vaccination is likely to be not that effective either, right? So we can't think that vaccine is going to solve the problem. Probably even vaccine may not solve the problem. Only God knows. So Shinu, after getting infected, do you think that you have become more careful, or you think you have become a little bit laid back or little less? Which way? Because I have seen people going both ways. After the infection, some of them, you can make out that they are relaxing a little. Some people are. So mentally, what do you feel now?
No, I think I've become more careful, because since I've gone through it once, I don't want to go through. I think God has helped me and my family get through it safely. So I shouldn't stretch my chances more. And I am more careful. And even my family members remind me more and more to be careful, and they themselves are more careful. Yeah, we don't know anything about the reinfection things, right? Or how it can come and why it comes. So better be careful. Yeah.
Kamala, what do you think this pandemic and this infection has taught you? If you say there is one lesson you've learned out of this whole mess, what would that be?
We should always be cautious, and we should be ready to face any kind of situation, ma'am. We can never say it will not come for me. So whatever the situation is, we should face it. From our part, we should be cautious. At the same time, when we get it, we should be able to tide over the situation. That is the lesson I have learned.
And Dr. Deepthi, you'd like to say something? You are muted, ma'am. You need to unmute.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes.
So when we saw different kind of presentation in each of us, I would like to say that every person is not going to have only mild symptoms. It can be a moderate or a severe. So we have to be careful. We can get the infection again. So you have to be more careful. Plus, I would say that with medical rehabilitation, we need a psychological rehabilitation programs also. And for that, in our ISA group, with few friends, we have started a helpline kind of thing, where we advise people who have been suffering. They just send us message on WhatsApp, and we have been helping them on a WhatsApp group. Thanks, madam. And I think it has been helping them a lot, because everyone is too scared. Being a non-medico or a lay person, they are really scared of quarantine and so many small things for which they cannot contact their own doctors, or they cannot go to the hospital. So it really helps them. So psychological rehabilitation has to be done along with the medical rehabilitation. And one final message I would say is that virus spread, we all know, but I would still like to insist that this virus spreads by following it spreads with 5 P. One is when the many people are there, means a lot of people get together in poorly ventilated area, that is another P. Protection free, that is without the mask, and they stay in a close proximity and for a prolonged period, is very dangerous for any of us or any of the people. So we have to still educate them for this, because people are still not following. So I don't want, even when I suffered, I don't want my near ones or my dear ones to suffer and to go through this ordeal. So I would say you better take care of yourself. That's the message I would say.
So, Dr. Suresh, how have you tried to imbibe all these things that Dr. Deepti said in your workplace, among the technicians, nurses, and everyone? Because what I have noticed now is, if we are very strict at the workplace, then their behavior in public also is, changed. The same young boys who are, being very casual in the beginning in my technicians and nurses and all that, once one of them got it, and then, we put strict things in place and we started monitoring, surveillance, if required, audit, everything of what they are doing, So, Big Brother is watching kind of thing. Maybe they cursed me for it. Maybe they thought that I was such a terror or whatever. But the upside of it is, after June, we have hardly seen anything. We had a cluster in our hospital in June, but after we put all the systems in place. So do you think that the way we behave and the way we make people behave in the workplace will actually help the community also? Do you believe that?
Yes, I definitely believe that. And, in the early part of this COVID, everybody was so afraid, and everybody was taking precautions. But after a few months, everybody was relaxed and nobody was taking any precautions. Even the doctors was, eating together in a closed room. But I was the first doctor who got in our hospital. But when I got infected and other anesthetists also got infected, then everybody again started taking precautions. But nursing staff, these sweepers, these ward boys, they are still not aware of the disease dangers. And they are still, like a public society, day before yesterday, one complete video came from one oil. Hundreds or 200 people were dancing there, and they were get together. So public at large, not following any precautions for the COVID, and for the in the Jaipur, I don't see in the society that they are afraid of COVID.
Dr. Raghavendran, have you kind of spearheaded the safety thing in your apartment complex? Do you live in an independent house or an apartment complex, sir?
No, I stay in an independent house. Okay.
So maybe that question is not really valid for you, but Kamala, do you stay in an apartment complex?
Yes, ma'am, I stay in apartments only.
Yeah, so are you the only doctor, or there are other doctors in that complex?
No, ma'am, I'm the only doctor in my apartment.
So are you the go-to person? I mean, are you the go-to person for the entire apartment complex when they have doubts, or if anyone gets sick, or especially in this COVID time, have you been the anchor, sort of educating them, helping them, and is that how, or you are too busy at work to get involved in?
No, ma'am. Before my infection, before I got the infection itself, people are very cautious. So they, everyone have started following the safety precautions, sanitizing the hands once they enter the house, and taking bath once they enter the house. Always they wear face mask once when they're out of the house. So all these precautions they follow. And after me getting the infection and my entire family was isolated, they've become more cautious about that. Seeing my father getting admitted, so they're now cautious. And till now, there is no other infection in our apartments, ma'am.
Oh, great. So, Nidhi, are you alone at this moment? Or, you're in isolation means, are you actually alone, or how is it?
No, ma'am, I am living with my mother-in-law and father-in-law in a rented house. We live in an apartment. Uh-huh. So, I was the first one to get infected in my apartment. But people here are very conscious about hand sanitizing and social distancing. So, they are like, after I got infected, they once visited me and my mother-in-law and father-in-law about asking about tests, whether they should get tested or not. But all over, I had a pleasant experience of my surrounding, and they are very cautious about everything.
Yeah, in-laws are all right. They are fine.
Yeah, ma'am, they are fine.
Oh, yes, thank God for that.
From the very first day, I isolated myself from the very first symptom. So,
yeah,
So they are fine now.
So it's a very important thing to be not be in denial, right? When you are having fever and you are tired, yes, instead of thinking that maybe it's not COVID, I think first thing within the family we should isolate ourselves so that yes, you know other people don't get infected right away, right? So yeah.
Yes.
So Suren, are you there? Suren and Hetal, are either of you there? Okay, so maybe they gone back to work. So yeah, so if anyone has anything to say, please go ahead. Otherwise, maybe we should call it a day. It's been more than an hour since we've been chatting. Does anyone have anything to add? Please feel free to talk. Raghavendran sir, Nidhi, anyone? Would you like to say something?
As someone who has suffered this infection, and that we have got responsibility to prevent it to go to others and all. So what I have done is sort of, you know, teach as much as possible the importance of, you know, personal protection with the people, you know, say some people are coming to house like servant maids and drivers and all. So that discipline we have inculcated in them, and then they are following it now. So, and wherever you go, whenever you see someone not wearing mask properly, the theater or something, we always insist upon that they should come after proper, you know, hygiene and protection, mask wearing, you know. So, but I think now people are all quite conscious now after seeing the media has really done this much, you know, publicity. So, and bad publicity, I should say, that I think people are getting scared and then they are following now without we telling us also. But this the spread of infection in houses many times comes from the workers, and then they bring it actually, even though they may not suffer. So that possibility has to be kept in mind. And when we got infected, no, say we just first thing we told them was not to come, and then go stay in your house for almost 14 days, and then if anytime you develop any symptoms, immediately go to the hospital. And that sort of education we have to create in them. That's important.
So at least we can make a difference within our family and within the apartment complex and within our employees and co-workers. If each of us, in our own microsystem, if we bring in some discipline and precautions, I think together we can make a big difference. I mean, if I can make 20 or 30 people be careful, and say we are 5,000 plus Tassians, and all of us can make, each of us can make another 20, 30 people cautious, I think we will make a big difference. So, does anyone else want to say anything? Bhargav sir, you would like to say anything?
No, thank you.
Okay. Nidhi, would you like to say something?
Ma'am, I just want to tell everyone that do not ignore symptom. Even if it is a mild symptom, just get tested. And after you test positive, be positive. Be mentally strong.
On that,
get
on
surrounded
that,
by positive people.
Yeah. So
that actually helps, ma'am.
Another P to add to Dr. Deepthi's piece. She was telling the minus side piece, so I'm sure she has a set of plus side piece. So Dr. Deepthi, would you like to say what are the positive piece we should follow? You can unmute yourself, ma'am. Unmute yourself.
Be positive. So that is another one P. And you can inculcate these kind of information to the public, as you said. So public awareness is another P has to be inculcated. So that 2P I can get.
And you said you must surround yourself with positive people.
Yeah, yes. That's the most important thing I would say. Because Hetal, you won't believe, Hetal, in between all this, he said, ma'am, anytime medical emergency, he would just drop in the house and take care of everything. So that kind of positive people really help you around. And it gives a peace of mind, because we were worried that what will happen if my in-laws get positive? What will happen to them? How will we manage? So, yes, positive people will help. Thanks, that's all.
And on that very positive note, thank you all of you for joining us today and sharing what could possibly be very personal experience. And I hope that you, all of you, would have given a lot of hope and strength to others in our TAS family, some of whom may be, you know, positive now and going through this issue. And also, a word of caution to all those who were who may be taking it lightly. So thank you everybody, and thanks Suren for getting us all together on Zoom, and thanks Hetal and Anil for thinking up of doing this program. Thank you one and all.
Thanks Vidya ma'am for conducting this so well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you all.
Baba, what an awesome.